Hello, and today we are with Mr. John Samuel, who is the Senior Vice President Design of Sabre. Good afternoon to you, John.
It's great to be here.
Well, thank you very much indeed for your time. I know you're very busy here at the Travel Technology Exchange here in Beijing. How has the show been going, the event been going for you so far?
Oh, it's been great. I've never been to China before, so this has been very exciting to visit China. I had a wonderful evening last night, met a lot of great people from really all over the world. Especially all over the Asia-Pacific region, and we have a lot of folks with us today. So it's been a great start so far.
Now, you head my favorite section of Sabre, which is Sabre Labs. It's the bit that gets me most excited. You're the chemistry lab. You are basically the creating what doesn't exist, and even enhancing that which it does. But you have a very interesting title, first of all. You have Senior Vice President Design. We're not working with a fashion house here. What is the design element? Where does that come in?
Well, as I'll talk about later, design impacts all parts of the software experience. And the principles of design, which are around understanding the user, understanding those users' needs, and then that translates into how to design our products. But as that matures, that also translates into what products should we create. The more you understand the user needs, the more you're empathetic with the user, the better you can be at designing products, determining what products we need to be looking at in the future, understanding how emerging technology is going to impact our users and our customers. So I view those worlds, even though they don't seem like they go together first, I actually view them all on the same continuum of about understanding the end user.
I think that's very interesting, and that is exactly why Sabre is such an important component of the travel industry and aviation industry as a whole. From your perspective, within Sabre Labs, which is the bit that gets you the most excited when you wake up in the morning? Which are the first little bits that you go and check on?
Oh, I love creating new products, and so I enjoy hearing kind of what's going on in the industry, especially new startups or new innovation out in the industry. Travel is an amazing industry in that it's so large and it has so many different aspects to it that there's almost always something new going on in some part of the space, and I enjoy that part. So it's absolutely what can we do next? What are new things that we can create?
One of those new things is messaging. A lot of people are talking about that, and that is something which is going to be coming up at TTX here in Beijing. Could you tell us about this? What are you doing with messaging, and where is it going?
I'm really excited about the prospects of messaging. I think it addresses some of the challenges that, as mobile has emerged, there's been this plethora of apps, and while that's been wonderful, and they do a fantastic job, when you actually look at the data, people only use 8 to 10 apps on their phone frequently. And even though they might have 100 apps on their phone, they're really only using a few. And by the way, those tend to be messaging apps. The unique users on some of the, per month, on some of the big messaging platforms, WeChat here in China, or Facebook Messenger in the United States, Facebook Messenger boasts over a billion unique users a month. So the reach of these messaging platforms is kind of unparalleled. And what they enable is the ability for our customers, whether that be travel agents or airlines or hotels, it enables our customers to get a much broader reach and much more accessible reach to their customers and to their travelers. So I think we're just getting started. Everybody's still trying to figure out how this is going to work, what parts of it will be voice, what parts will be text, what parts will be automated, what parts will be human, what parts will still have a graphical interface, and what parts will just be text. I think those are all questions that we're going to be answering probably over the next few years. But I think the emergence of the trend is kind of undeniable.
When how long do you think it'll be before Sabre has a product in that domain that you're really excited about?
Well, the way labs and studios works is we experiment with technologies all the time. So we actually have some prototypes that are working already. Now they're not ready for market. We're not ready to announce anything yet. But we are working on what those prototypes could be, and what we're trying to do is build it in such a way that we can have platforms and services that others can build on top of, and we'll do some of the plumbing and kind of underpinning technology that's required to be successful in these platforms. As these emerge, you're going to want to talk to multiple platforms. Like I said, whether it's WeChat or GroupMe or LinkedIn or whatever channel you want to use, and we're going to help make that easier for our customers.
When do you say stop? As you mentioned, a lot of people have too many apps on their phone. They use battery power and this, that, the other, but they only tend to use about four or five of them every day. When is technology just there for technology's sake because somebody's able to design an app that, well, I like the look of that, but when do you say stop in terms of Sabre saying, well, this isn't maybe making any advantage to the end user?
But I think that's why I'm so excited about messaging, is because all messaging is doing is just replicating human interaction. We're not going to stop talking to each other. And really, messaging is just an extension of that. It's why I always laugh. I have three children. Sending my children an email is a waste of time. They don't read their email. They don't look at email. Sending them a text message is what they check the most often and what they interact with. And they interact with their friends socially that way. So I'm pretty confident that this will be kind of the vehicle for choice. In fact, Kleiner Perkins did a study this year that talked about how different age groups want to interact with companies, and this youngest age group in particular would much prefer to interact via a social channel than they would through an app, and of course even by calling on the phone. So times are changing. So I actually view this as a direct response to your question, which is these are a lot more seamless and baked into how we all live versus having to download a separate app for a single purpose. And so that's why I think this is going to get a lot of traction.
Another thing which a lot of people are talking about, throwing words around, virtual reality, augmented reality. It all sounds very nice, but is it really going to make any difference? And what are you doing with regards to Sabre Labs and Sabre Studios with regards to these two products?
Yeah, I have been in travel for a few years, and yes, we've been talking about virtual reality for quite some time. Like a lot of things, however, the technology is catching up to the dream of what this could be about. You've probably seen some relatively low-cost capabilities that enable the average consumer to get access to virtual reality capabilities. What I think that means for travel, of course, we'll see. But the most obvious expectation is that you as a traveler would be able to know a lot more about any decision you're about to make for an upcoming trip. So what does my hotel room look like? How do I get through the airport? What does that beach view really look like? You will get a much more realistic picture of the things you're purchasing. You know, in the travel industry, there's always been this dilemma of, they call it the surprise factor, of you book a hotel and that moment of truth when you open the door and you hope that you have a nice room. Virtual reality is going to make that a lot less of a experiment, and a lot more, you'll have a lot more confidence about what you're buying and that you're going to have a great experience. Augmented reality, just to add on that, augmented reality in particular is a little different, because augmented reality will use things that are already in place and complement them with more information. So I think that, the obviously applications, some of those will be back office, helping pilots, helping front desk, helping people that work for our suppliers, but also for the traveler as well, as they can maybe look at a city and see where all the coffee shops are or public transportation options, that kind of thing.
Another component within technology is wearable technology. What are some of the areas of wearable technology that excite you that Sabre can work with on the industry and the consumer side to develop products there?
Well, easily our most of our activity today has been around watches. That's gotten the largest traction, with not only Apple's watch, but almost all the other large players have some form of watch form factor. So that's going to be first. It's nice because it doesn't require a significant change from the user's behavior, where the glasses and other things like that are a little bit different, there's a little bit more adoption challenge for some of those technologies. I don't know what'll be next there. One of my favorites that I've heard about is shoes that have sensors in them that can actually help you with directions by literally buzzing when you need to turn right or left or that kind of thing. So I think you'll see more wearables, but I think it'll probably be a longer curve than some of the other capabilities.
Well, what are some of the other things that I haven't asked you about, the Sabre Labs and Sabre Studios, that you're excited in, of in specific technology that you might be releasing soon?
Well, the area that we're spending a lot of time on is I guess you could call it a little nerdy, but it is the area of machine learning, artificial intelligence. How can we take this rich amount of data that we have, make sense of it, and go from providing search capabilities to providing recommendation capabilities? How do we do a better job of marrying what we know about the traveler's needs, the traveler's context, and even the context around the traveler, what time of day it is, what the weather outside is, those kind of things? How do we marry all those things together to present smarter and smarter recommendations as opposed to always requiring the user to search for information? I think that world is still early stage, and but going to get materially better even in the next few years. There's been a lot of progress on that front.
Here we're talking a lot about technology. Sabre works does a lot in CSR. One of the areas of CSR that a lot of companies work for is in terms of education, finding people to write all of these code to do these sort of things. When you started writing code, we were working on different systems. You used cassette tapes to record, I believe.
That's right.
Today, how is Sabre trying to increase and attract those to learn more about coding and for you to actually educate some of them?
Right. I think as people are understanding how prevalent technology is going to be, no matter what walk of life they choose, that technology is going to play a larger and larger role whatever they might be interested in. As I mentioned earlier, I have three kids and they're all kind of making decisions about what they want to do. I've encouraged them to make sure they have a core set of technology skills. So we've started now going at the high school level, certainly I'm involved at the college level and above, to talk to students and tell them about kind of the exciting intersection between technology and travel, and how having skills in both of those areas can lead to a pretty fulfilling career in terms of opportunities.
In terms of location, of course, you have the four major areas, London, America, Dallas, Fort Worth. You have Singapore as well, and South America. Each different region of the world, of course, have different cultural and different language and also different technology needs.
That's right.
What is Sabre doing about that in those different areas, and how do you separate them, say, right, this is more for the Asia Pacific, or can you?
Well, it goes back to how we began the whole discussion. It goes back to understanding the user, and one of the things we're trying to do is do a better job of making sure the user research we're performing is global, that it represents the unique needs of the different marketplaces. For instance, in this part of the world, Australia, etc., it's much more common to visit a brick-and-mortar travel agency than it is in the United States. Understanding those differences and what consumers expect and are looking for from an agency is very important, and it requires being there, talking to folks, and really understanding, and as I say, being empathetic to what the user is trying to accomplish.
Here at the event, the Travel Technology Exchange here in Beijing, what are you, from your perspective within Sabre, trying to get out of this event?
Well, I think what we just talked about would probably be top of my list, which is talking to people, understanding the differences, as you mentioned, the differences between what I'm more familiar with, of course, which is the U.S. market, understanding the differences. I'm going to talk later today about messaging, as we discussed earlier. Well, in many ways, this part of the world is far more evolved than the United States in the adoption of messaging capabilities. WeChat will do over 500 billion in transaction capabilities through WeChat this year. There's no U.S. messaging platform that's nearly that far along. So I'm looking to gain a lot of insight from those in the market about what those differences are and what we should be paying attention to as we're deciding what to build.
Of course, it's just over a year since Sabre acquired Abacus. You are going to be keeping your eyes, you mentioned startups, you'll always keep your eyes on the new technology. Are there any particular companies or any particular companies that you've got your eye on at the moment that are very, that you're looking at and thinking, I like what they're doing?
There might be, and I'm not sure those I want to talk about, because we never know what we might do in the future. But yes, we keep tabs on quite a few. We watch where venture capital's going. We watch what the market is paying attention to, and that's always insightful.
And finally, for my last question, if we sit down again in 10 years, a lot of the technology that we've discussed, we've been discussing for a while, to be honest. That's virtual reality and a few of the others have been around. In 10 years' time, do you have any thoughts about what we might be discussing?
Who knows? That's a tough question. It's funny. I think what will probably happen is we'll quit describing technology so uniquely from everything else. That I think if I had to kind of broadly comment, it would be that technology is going to blend, and you're not going to think of technology so much as a separate discipline from everything else. It'll just become more part of what we do. Terms like mobile, I was commenting on this earlier, terms like mobile are important now, but mobile, you won't use that term a few years from now because it'll just be, of course, like saying web today or phone. You know, those are existing technologies that we don't separately call out. So, you know, it's been said that technology is anything that's relatively new. And you don't think of your refrigerator as technology, but it is, and it's just a lot more mature. So I think that trend will continue, and it'll continue to blend into our everyday lives.
Excellent. Well, John, I have to say thank you very much indeed. It's been a pleasure and very interesting to talk to you today. And of course, I wish you and Sabre the best of luck for the future.
Thank you very much, and thanks for having me.
Thank you.